Will you stand and join hands with those nearest you, and let's pray together. Father, the Bible says, I was glad when they said to me, come into the house of the Lord. We're thankful to be here. We're thankful that you've invited us here by the greatness of your heart, the greatness of your mercy and love available to each one of us. Let us meet your open heart with our open hearts as we worship today in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. Let's worship together.
Redeemed by the blood to proclaim, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Shall see in his beauty the King in whose law I delight. Who lovingly guardeth my footsteps and giveth me sons of delight.
Seated.
Good morning. Nice. I like the enthusiasm. We're so happy to have you with us here in worship this morning. Especially glad to have you if you are a guest of ours for the first time. If you are one of our guests, we have a gift we'd like to give you as you leave the service today. You can introduce yourself to me or to Scott or one of our ushers or greeters, and we'll get that gift to you. One quick announcement before we have a good presentation from Compassion International. High school seniors, or those who know high school seniors, this is your time. It's coming up in a couple weeks, so if you haven't talked to Shannon yet, be sure to do that so we can get your name in the bulletin, make sure you go to lunch with us, all those things. High school seniors, be in touch with Shannon as soon as possible. It is Compassion International Sunday, so we're excited to have Lauren here to share some more information about that, so I'm going to turn it over to you now.
Can you hear me? Okay,
there we
good.
Go.
It's good to see everybody. I wanted to come today and just take a few moments of your time to tell you about an organization that's very dear to my heart. It's Compassion International. Today is Compassion Sunday, and Christians all over the country, and even next Sunday, will be sharing in churches about their ministry on behalf of children living in poverty all over the world. And I wanted to share with you today just about the changing impact that compassion sponsorship, that you as a compassion sponsor could have on the life of a child. I want to start, though, by just showing you a short video. It shows the story of one child living in poverty and just the powerful impact that compassion has had on her life. Thank you.
A child is waiting.
A child is waiting.
There are children around the world waiting.
Children are waiting.
I live here with my family, my mom and dad, and all my brothers. I am the only daughter. Our home is built over a very dirty river. And when the storms happen, our home floods with water and garbage. This is a scary place when it gets dark. People get drunk and fight all the time. I do not go outside at night because I don't know what would happen. Even though I live in this place, I have been sponsored for 14 years by Arlie and Nancy. I call them Mom and Dad.
Mom and Dad.
Although we are countries apart, I know they chose me. They tell me, Eunice, we remember you. We love you. You are like our own daughter. Because of my sponsors, I had the opportunity to go to the Compassion Program at the church in my neighborhood. For all these years, my sponsors and my church have helped me to receive better food and medicine. With the help of my sponsors, I will be able to work, to help my own family. When I was 9, my Compassion teacher shared Jesus with us. And that's when I accepted Christ. Even though I am poor, He has provided my church. He gave me sponsors who love me. God will never leave us. I want to share everything I have learned with kids who are like me, other children who need sponsors because they also experience poverty. I want them to feel the joy of having a sponsor, to get a letter that says, I love you, you are special to me. With the help of our sponsors, we can grow up and finish our studies and learn how to live our faith in Jesus. I want to serve the Lord, and I won't stop serving Him because He does not stop loving me and taking care of me and my family.
There are children around the world waiting. Waiting for a sponsor like you.
Like you.
Release a child from poverty in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name. A child is waiting for you.
It's always fun to watch those videos and see how children have been impacted across the world, but Lauren has actually been doing this for years and has been impacted personally. So Lauren, share with us just a little bit of how this has impacted your faith journey.
Well, for me, we started sponsoring a Compassion child named Abriel. She's the one on the far left. When she was 8 years old, she's 18 there in the picture. I was still a little girl and I was living at home, and Mom and I sponsored her. For me, you know, I turn on the news and I see all the suffering in the world, and, you know, you hear about the poverty, the wars, and you just feel powerless. What can you do? You know, it's so discouraging. But when I learned about Compassion, for me, it was empowering because I felt like I could make a difference. I can't end worldwide poverty. I can't feed every starving child, but I can sponsor one child or two children or however many, and I can make a difference in their lives and share the love of Jesus with them. You know, and it's just, you really can make a difference. You know, Abril was, like I was saying, was just 8 when we started sponsoring her, so we got a picture of her. She's this cute little 8-year-old girl in a cute little dress, and she lives in Mexico. And so, you know, over the next 10 years, we sponsored her till she graduated from the program a couple years ago. And, you know, you always wonder if you're really making a difference, you know, because that's a long time. You know, you're sending your monthly donation, which Amy will tell you about in a minute, and, you know, you're praying and you're sending letters, and you just kind of wonder, well, you know, is it really making a difference? And a couple years ago, you know, when she graduated, she sent my mom and I this letter, and it just meant so much because she just talked about what it had meant to her over the years, you know, and so you really are making a difference even when you don't know you are. And just how she said, because of her relationship with us, she believed that long-distance friendship really could exist, you know. And she's also, she was applying to colleges last in that letter, that last letter she sent us. I still think of her often. I wish I could tell her, you know, we hadn't forgotten about you just because she graduated the program. But I mean, that never would have been possible, you know, without compassion and that, you know, God's intervention through them in her life, you know, to have that dream of going to college and all. So it's been a real blessing. And I think we have a Bible verse on a slide. Yes. Okay. I was just going to share this real quick. Proverbs 31:8, as you can see, speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves, for the rights of all who are destitute. And that's just really powerful for me. And compassion sponsorship to me is one way I can do that. You know, you can be a voice for those children who don't have a voice. So thank you.
So there's so much more to learn about Compassion International. Lauren will be out at a table in the narthex after the service. Sponsorships are $38 a month. That's equivalent to about one meal for a family of four if you go out to eat. And so consider that. Consider ways that you can partner with this ministry that goes into local communities and partners with community organizations that are already present. So Compassion International's ministry is a wonderful thing to be a part of. Hope you'll go visit Lauren and get more information. And I hope you'll fill out your blue care card, which I forgot to ask you to do earlier. On the front, place to put that you're here this morning. On the back, prayer request. Be sure to get that and know that those will be prayed for throughout the week. Again, so glad to have you here with us in worship this morning. I ask you now to stand and greet those around you.
Continue to worship together. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me.
Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior. So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Offer of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save.
Sing it together.
One final breath He gave as heaven looked away. The Son of God was laid in darkness. The battle in the grave.
sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah. 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 We sing hallelujah.
He lives. The Bible tells us that Jesus lives now. He sits at the right hand of the Father and he makes intercession. He prays for the saints. He prays for you and me. So we join together in our prayers this morning. Prayers for many concerns from our congregation. You'll be patient with me as I walk through all these. We pray for Jason Haley. Jason is the son of Laura White. Jason is battling cancer and some surgeries right now in Texas. Remember Rusty Rains. Rusty remains hospitalized. Remember Rusty and Julie. Rusty's hospitalized after a surgery earlier this week. Continue to pray for Rusty and Julie and their family. Love them and their family. Pray for Bureau Wilborn. That's Kay Daniels' mother. I probably didn't even say that right. Did I get it right? Kay's here. Pray for Kay, too. His Bureau is in rehab, and they're having to make some care decisions for her and for her husband as well. Remember Emma Armour. Emma is the grandchild of Dan and Helen Phillips. Emma is up in Cleveland, Ohio, preparing for a major surgery. Emma's less than a year old and has to have a significant surgery this Tuesday. Pray for Jim Houseel. Jim is a Methodist preacher called out of the St. Mark Church a couple of decades ago. Jim had a fall and is in rehab this week down in Moultrie, so pray for him. For the family of Pat Killingsworth, after her death last week, Pat's funeral services will be this Tuesday. 2:00 at Park Hill Cemetery. And our friend of the week is Charles Downey. You'll see his details in the bulletin and can reach out and show him a sign of your love and affirmation. I think that's everybody. It's everybody we know about a name, right? Because you bring your own concerns and your own cares. Let's go together to the Lord in prayer. Oh God, you are our shepherd. And with you as our shepherd, we lack nothing that we truly need. You make us lie down in green pastures. You lead us beside quiet waters. You refresh our souls. You guide us along right paths for the sake of your name, which you've given to us. Even though we walk through the darkest of valleys, we can walk fearing no evil because we know that you are with us. With your rod and with your staff, you comfort us. Oh God, as we come together to worship you today, may we come aware of how wide and how high and how deep is your shepherding love for us. You reach toward us in the places where we are most broken, and you want to pour out healing for us. You reach out to the places where we're not thinking correctly, and even our thoughts of you may, our bad thinking about you may prevent us from wanting to come closer to you. pain about the past may be so great. Our fear of the future may be so great. But even in the midst of our fear or our pain, speak words of comfort and hope. Lead us today by still waters. Refresh and restore our souls. Oh God, let us know again. Let us know the shepherd love of Jesus Christ, who came and who healed and who taught and who loved enough to give himself for us. Father, pour out on us the shepherd love, the power of that shepherd love that raised Jesus from the dead, and pour out on us your Holy Spirit, that we who have experienced your shepherd love might be signs of your shepherd love in the world. Oh God, pour out your love on all those who are sick physically, on all those who are distracted emotionally, on those who grieve, on those who are lonely. We bring these that we've named, and we bring our own concerns to you, trusting them all to your shepherd love. Jesus has loved us, so he has taught us. And we pray together as your children, using his word, saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, friends. Let's all sit on the floor. I know this stage is the new normal for us, but it'll be okay. On the floor. All right. So, how are y'all doing this morning? Good. I'm going to tell y'all a story. Does anybody up here, raise your hand, if you know who my dad is?
Mr. Aaron.
Mr. Aaron, it's my husband. That's right, Mr. Shannon. Wait, that Mr. Shannon? Wherever? Shannon Gaither, that's right, he's over there. Does anybody know what he used to do when I was y'all's age? He teaches swimming, he teaches school, but there's something else he used to do that probably none of y'all know. He used to jump out of airplanes. Not skydiving. He did it in the Army. Have y'all ever jumped out of an airplane?
No.
I haven't either. When I was little, I didn't think that was that impressive, but now it's pretty impressive, right, that he jumped out of an airplane? So what do you think he wore when he jumped out of an airplane?
Army suit.
Sam? He didn't wear a skydiving suit. Oh, I heard it. Was that Logan? He wore a parachute. So what does a parachute do? Let's raise our hand. Let's raise our hand. We're getting out of control.
It releases.
It releases.
Like,
mm-hmm. That's right. It keeps you from hitting the ground too hard, right? And so, what would happen if he jumped out and his parachute didn't work, Sam? He would splatter everywhere. Shh. Calm down. We're almost done. All right. And so what did he have to have in his parachute when he jumped out? There's a word I'm looking for. It starts with an F. No, he has to have a certain thing in his... Not follow, not fire. Faith. He had to have faith in his parachute, right? Y'all know what faith is? Okay, well, we're going to talk more about faith was the whole point of that story. So let's bow our heads and close our eyes, and we'll do more when we get down the hall. All right. Dear Jesus, thank you for being our parachute. Help us learn to have faith in you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Father, we praise you that by faith we do know your goodness, and that because of your faithfulness, we've seen your blessing at work in our lives. We ask, God, now that you would stir in us a generosity to lead us to be faithful so that others may come to know of your great love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
not in a magnet school. He needs to be, man. That was really, really good. A lot of neat things. We have the kids up here. Kind of a crazy 8:30 service. I think mics are working now. No mic was working right at the 8:30 service, so we have sound now. But we remember God's in control, right, of all of that stuff. God's in control when the children's sermon goes kind of one way. All right, there it is. It's like making noises again. It's like I'm singing myself. Lost it completely. I shouldn't have talked about it. Is that one working? Okay. The lesson is the same. Okay, I'm back. God is in control, right? And you as Christian, in a world where it seems like everything's out of control sometimes, in a world where it seems like everything's out of your control, we can have confidence in this. We can choose faith in Christ. We can choose to obey the voice of the Lord. We can choose God because we know that God is ultimately in control. There's some crazy things in the world. I read this story about a dad in suburban Cleveland. Be glad that you don't have this dad, okay? He wanted to test his children's preparedness for a home emergency. And so while he left his kids at home, he hired an ex-con to come and try to break into the house. The kids let him in and then barricaded themselves in a top-story bedroom before escaping out a window and calling 911 from down the street. Okay, crazy dad, right? Crazy kids, I guess they made it out, right? Crazy world. A lot of crazy things. We live in a world where, human trafficking, we want to think that the slave trade is something that we read about in history. Human trafficking is still as prevalent as ever. War everywhere, even on the individual level. There are some of you here today, and you're facing family challenges, and some of them are relational or economic, work-related or money-related or just people-related. Sometimes the evidence around us shows us that we live in a world where it doesn't seem anyone is in control. But I want to tell you, as we look at the book of Daniel, I want to assure you from Scripture that you can choose faith confidently. You can choose to love God and follow Him confidently because He is in control. At the end of the story, He is in control. Daniel's new territory for me. I've never preached or taught from the book of Daniel, and so this is kind of neat for me. And the book of Daniel for us, Daniel takes place at a time of war, a time of superpower politics, a time of economic heartbreak, and a time of religious tumult. But a time when individual believers who want to live faithfully, who want to honor God with their lives, still can do that. And I think the story of Daniel is recorded just for that, to help us to endure and persevere and trust that God is in control even when it seems like He may not be. Look with me at the first chapter of Daniel, and I'm going to read the whole chapter. And it's a little chunk there, but we'll read that together. In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, came over to Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord then delivered Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, along with some of the articles from the temple of God. And these he carried off to the temple of his God in Babylonia, and he put them in the treasure house of his God. And then that king, King Nebuchadnezzar, ordered Ashpenaz, the chief of his court officials, to bring into the king's service some of the Israelites from the royal family and from the nobility, young men without any physical defect, handsome, showing aptitude for every kind of learning, well-informed, quick to understand, and qualified to serve in the king's palace. He was to teach them the language and the literature of the Babylonians. The king assigned them a daily amount of food and wine from the king's table, and they were to be trained there for 3 years, and after that they would enter the king's service. Among those who were chosen were some from Judah: Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. And the chief official gave them new names: to Daniel the name Belteshazzar, to Hananiah Shadrach, to Mishael Meshach, and to Azariah Abednego. But Daniel resolved not to defile himself with the royal food and the royal wine, and he asked the chief official for permission not to defile himself in this way. Now God caused that official to have favor, to show favor and compassion to Daniel, but the official told him, "I am afraid of my lord the king, who has assigned you your food and your drink. Should he see you looking worse than the other young men your age, the king would then have my head because of you." Daniel then said to the guard whom the chief official had appointed over Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, "Please test your servants for these 10 days. Give us nothing but vegetables to eat and water to drink, and then compare our appearance with that of the young men who eat the royal food, and treat your servants in accordance with what you see." So he agreed to this, and he tested them for 10 days, and at the end of the 10 days, they looked healthier and better nourished than any of the young men who ate the royal food. And so the guard took away their choice food and the wine they were to drink and gave them vegetables instead. To these four young men, God gave knowledge and understanding of all kinds of literature and learning, and Daniel could understand visions and dreams of all kinds. And at the end of the time set by the king to bring them into his service, the chief official presented them to Nebuchadnezzar, and the king talked with them, and he found no one equal to Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. And so they entered into the king's service, and in every manner of wisdom and understanding about which the king questioned them, he found them 10 times better than the magicians and enchanters in his whole kingdom. And Daniel remained there until the first year of King Cyrus. Let's pray together. Father, we cannot live by bread alone. We live by every word which comes to us from your mouth. Open today our ears, our minds, and our hearts that we could receive and live in your living word, who is Jesus Christ. Amen. I love the story of Daniel. It's one of those Old Testament stories that we can date with precision. The third year of Jehoiakim's kingship, the third year, it's the year 605 BC. And at this point, Judah, Israel, the people of God, their territory has shrunk and their influence in the world has shrunk and their kingdom itself is about to disappear. It was one of those times when you might think that God was losing the battle, that God was no longer in control. Jerusalem, their city, their favored city, the capital city, David's city, Jerusalem was under siege. The temple itself, the seat of Israelite worship, the pride and joy of any Israelite, the temple itself was being sacked, and the cups and plates and candlesticks were being carried off from that, not just carried off and melted down, but carried off and taken into a foreign king's temple, into a foreign god's temple, and there to be abused and misused in worship there. So their city and their country was at risk. Their temple, their worship life was at risk, and their young people were at risk. What always happens in today and then, when a superpower comes in and wants to take over, they want to pluck the cream of the crop, the best of the young people. They want to take them and re-educate them according to their norms. Because as the Babylonians conquered kingdom after kingdom, they didn't want to just wipe the place out. They still needed people to administer, to run the farms, and to get the produce, and to manage this vast empire. So they chose the best Jewish kids, the best Israelite kids. Daniel, at this point, probably 13, 14 years old. We're not talking like 35-year-old Daniel. Teenagers, guys. This is you, okay? They're going in there choosing you. And so they said, "We're going to train you. We're going to make you agents of the foreign superpower, and we're going to send you back, and you're going to run things our way." And so what are they going to do? It's a new curriculum, a new education. They're not going to learn about the God of their fathers. They're not going to sit at the feet of their mothers and their grandmother and learn about Jehovah and about the covenant God made with Moses and with all of Israel. They're going to be trained in the literature and the learning of the Babylonians, the Akkadian stuff. They're going to learn how to read liver omens. They're going to learn how to understand the birds flying and astrology and all this crazy pagan stuff. This is going to be their future. So not just their curriculum changed, their name changed. They had great Jewish names. Daniel means God will judge. Hananiah, Azariah, all these are names that have theological meaning. And so they took away their Hebrew names and they're giving them Babylonian names that link them to the Babylonian God. So their names are changed. Even their physical persons are changed. Ashpenaz, the chief official of all the court officials, the literal translation there, he's the chief of the eunuchs. And now it doesn't say specifically, you know what a eunuch is? You might know what a eunuch is. Yeah, that may be too much for 11 o'clock on Sunday morning. A eunuch is a man who's no longer a man, right? They just have surgery. And so probably it's a good chance that Daniel and his three companions, they were done with what every other man that was conscripted into this kind of service was done. They were made eunuchs. They had changes to their education, to their name, even to their physical identity. They were co-opted by the superpower of the day. And I want to tell you this. The world always does this. The superpower always does this because its culture and its pattern is true, or so it believes. I'll tell you about my friend Chris. Chris grew up in Liberia, and she was one of the best and the brightest of her generation, and she was chosen by a superpower. She was chosen by a superpower and taken to a foreign city and trained to be a physician. She learned the language and she learned the culture in Krasnodar, Russia, in the Soviet Union. But they took her one place too far. She excelled in every area in medical school, fives, top marks in every area. She crept around secretly and found ways to worship and be true to her Christian faith. But it was up to this last point. To graduate from medical school in the Soviet Union, you had to write and defend a project on scientific atheism. You had to prove and give a testimony and a signed document to prove that God did not exist. And for Chris, that was too far. For Chris, that was too far. The superpower had loved her and cultivated her and grew her, but to a point, she could go no farther, and so she rejected that class, and they rejected her. They took her papers, her documents, expelled her from school and from the country. She ended up in Sweden, blessed the Swedes. At one point, Sweden cultivated a rich Christian heritage, and they still have at least the hospitality from that. They welcome refugees still to this day from around the world. They welcome Chris. Eventually, she got to the States and was able to finish some other studies here in America. I tell you what, it won't be Babylon that comes to take us captive and to shape us by its culture. It won't be Russia or the Soviet Union that comes to try to shape us and make us into tools for its culture. It won't even be Islam. It may be our own super. It may be us. It may be the culture that grows up around us that will challenge us. And it won't look like pagan ideas. It'll look remarkably like me and like you. It'll look something like this. Dave Kinnaman and Gabe Lyons, in their newest book, Good Faith, they talk about the moral code of self-fulfillment that we seem to be facing in America, that we have created, really, in America. And at the beginning, it sounds innocuous to find yourself, look within yourself. That's what sells and passes as morality in our world today. But as Christians, we would say that may be a beginning. But to truly find yourself, discover the truth that is outside yourself, truth that is in Jesus Christ and in His Word. There is truth outside of you that has to be found and integrated for you to be a whole and full person. The self-fulfillment moral code tells us that to be fulfilled in life, pursue the things you desire most. The gospel of Jesus Christ tells us the opposite. That joy is ultimately not found in pursuing our own desires, but in giving ourselves. But in giving ourselves to bless others. The self-fulfilling moral code of the 21st century says that any kind of sexual expression between consenting adults is just fine. The Christian moral code, the code of Jesus Christ, says that in creation, God created certain boundaries, not for the diminishment of human beings, but for their flourishing. Friends, it may not be the pagan Babylonians, it won't be the Russians, and it won't be the Muslims that challenge our moral code. We will have created an alternate way ourselves. For Daniel and for his friends, that their witness is good for us. They could not control the changes in the world around them. They couldn't control the fact that a foreign king sacked their city. They couldn't control the fact that they were taken hostage, literally, and carried off into a foreign land. They couldn't control the curriculum around them. They couldn't control the fact that even their names were changed. But they had to believe that God was in control. And so there was this one place. I don't know why it's this place. I don't know why they didn't stop somewhere else at the name change or some other place. But they stopped here. They stopped with the offer of food. Some have said it's because of their devotion to the Old Testament kosher laws. They wanted to keep religiously pure and undefiled. Maybe. But maybe not. To receive food from the king's table, you see, that was more than just diet. To receive food from the king's table was a political statement, not just a dietary statement. To receive food from the king's table, to find your nourishment from the king's table, meant that you were on the take forever. That your life, your happiness, your nourishment belonged to the king. You were signing over. If you received that allowance, you were signing over your loyalty to the king. And for Daniel, that was something he couldn't do. Change my education, change my name, even change my physical person, but you will not change my loyalty. And so Daniel made a choice. Daniel's an excellent character study in wisdom, how he navigates this, how he navigates this decision, and how to execute and how to live that out. The Bible tells us God gave him favor. He went straight to the commander, and he asked for permission. Can I do this? Can I not eat this food? Can I eat these vegetables instead? And the commander, God says, the Bible says, God gave the commander compassion. Let Daniel find favor in his eyes. I wonder if that ever happened, that commander ever had compassion on anybody else as he executed his duties. But God did this. See, God's in control. Daniel made a choice. He made a request. God is in control. Daniel didn't get what he asked for. The commander said, no way. If you don't eat, if this thing falls apart, if you don't eat and you don't look good, the king will come hunting for me. Daniel said, okay. Daniel's wise, the right question, the right word, the right person, the right time. We know the Holy Spirit is not fully given in the Old Testament, but Daniel is operating under the wisdom of God's Spirit, I think, at this point, because he waits, he asks, you know, he asks the head guy, and when he doesn't get the answer he needs, he goes down a step and he asks the guard, the actual one who'll be delivering this meal every day to him. He says, guard, come here. Can we do this? We need to alter this diet plan. All this great stuff the king is offering is just too much for me. I've made a choice. I can't eat it. I need a simpler diet. Just bring me the cabbages and the potatoes and the parsnips and whatever else. Just bring me water, not wine. And the guard got into thinking about this. The guard thought, well, they're going to send all this food from the royal palace anyway, and it's just going to be sitting here, and I can either take it home to my family, or I can sell it and make a little on the side. So the guard said, yeah, we'll do this. And so Daniel said, yes, it's going to work. Only God could do this. Only God could do this. Only God could give this result. After 10 days, the trial, Daniel and his companions looked better than everyone else, and after the full three-year cycle, after the full three-year cycle, when God gave them, notice this, they were great students. They were capable from the beginning. But it's not their studies and it's not their teachers that get the credit. It's God that gets the credit. God gave, just like God gave the city of Jerusalem into the hand of Nebuchadnezzar. We thought the world was falling apart, but God was in control. Just like Daniel didn't know who to ask or how to get out of this situation, and he asked the commander, and God gave compassion, and God gave favor. So at the end of this process, God gave wisdom, and God gave learning, and they were 10 times smarter than everybody else who had gone through the course, and even the king saw it. Even Nebuchadnezzar saw it. God gave it. The lessons God gives you are better than any of the lessons you'll learn in life. The lessons God gives, a teacher can teach you, your parents can tell you, somebody can tell you, it'll go over your head. You might even be smart enough to know that you need to know what you need to know. I was in a seminar recently, and some other pastors, and there was talk about a book that had been meaningful to several of them, and everybody said, well, didn't you read that in seminary? And I went back and looked on my shelf, and sure enough, I had read the book. I just wasn't smart enough then to even know I needed that. It just went just right over my head. The lessons you know and you learn from God, they won't go over your head. Somebody tells you something, you get offended by it if it's not what you want to hear. Somebody tells you something, you can just, you bow up and you resist. The lessons God teaches you, those are the lessons that'll stick with you, that'll go with you forever. Tell you what, God gave them. God gave them wisdom and understanding, and they knew more about dreams, and they knew more about all the literature of the Babylonians than even the native Babylonians. And to an outsider, this looks crazy, because they're still mixed up in this crazy world of fortune-telling and future-telling. And the Bible doesn't say they didn't do it. The Bible just says God helped them do it even better than anybody else did. And we'll see some more in Daniel's life in the next couple of chapters as we go through this book. To an outsider, to somebody back home in Jerusalem, it might have looked like Daniel was a compromiser. like he had gone too far into this pagan world, but he was following God, and God was blessing him, and God was doing things that Daniel couldn't do by himself. So when you don't understand what other Christians are doing, be kind to them. Be kind to them, because you don't know what's going on and how God's working in their lives. God is in control. So what do we take home from this? What do we learn from Daniel? That you know, you can survive. God's with you if you're a vegetarian eunuch, okay? That's, you know, most of y'all are not going to be vegetarian eunuchs, so we got to find a different answer here. First, I'm going to tell you this. Choose privately first. Wherever you choose to honor God and obey him, choose privately first. Choose privately first. Daniel did not get his plate of vegetables and immediately snap a selfie, right, and say, hey, look at me, it's me and my veggies. Check out me and Shadrach and Meshach, we're right here. This is a private decision between him and God. Probably only 5 people in the whole world knew about it. Daniel knew, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah knew, and then this guard. Only 5 people knew. This wasn't something he was broadcasting. It was between him and God. It was between him and God. He was not on a hunger strike. He was not trying to draw attention to himself and start some kind of movement in the courts in Babylon. Didn't Jesus say some things about those who wanted to pray on street corners and wear flowing robes? Jesus said, if you want to pray, go in the closet and pray, because it's God's attention you want anyway. Jesus said to those who wanted to give and make flourishes and draw attention, go and hide. What you do in secret. Choose Christ privately first. Choose to obey him privately and quietly. Like the old revival preacher who goes into town without any big announcements. He rents a room, and he knows God wants to bring revival in the town, and so he takes out his chalk, and he draws a circle of chalk on the floor, and he steps into it, and he said, God, bring revival to this town, and bring it inside the circle before it gets outside the circle. Make a choice to trust God privately first. When you do share the choice, share it with other committed souls who are close to you. Choose privately first, and then choose to share it with those who you know are already in it with you. The Bible says a cord of 3 strands is not easily broken. I imagine there were days when Daniel looked at the food everyone else was eating, and he might have been tempted. That food looked great. But he had bound together in covenant with a few others close to him. Only a few people working together makes a difference. That's kind of the lesson of the compassion witness that we had from Lauren. A pastor here, a church there, a network that stretches around the world, not a big compassion, you know, giant compassion center, but small ministries and small places reaching people everywhere through the generosity of an individual here or a Sunday school class there. Share the choice. Commit to one another. We're not building a movement. We're simply trying to be obedient to God in the present moment. Choose privately. Share that choice with other persons committed near you. And finally, hold on with confidence to that choice. Hold on with confidence because God is in control. All of the first chapter of Daniel, this really isn't an important story in the whole of the story of Daniel. It's a prologue. The best verse in this story is verse 21. The last one. And Daniel remained there until the first year of King Cyrus. We see that Daniel made a choice, and Daniel trusted that God was in control, and the choice paid off for him. It didn't pay off that week, or the next week, or at the end of the year, but it paid off because from 605 BC to 539 BC, when King Cyrus showed up, who's still there? Daniel is still there. All the other enchanters and advisors of the kings and the royal officials, they have come and gone a dozen times. But who is still there? Daniel is still there because God is in control. After the fall of the Soviet Union, my friend Chris, remember her? She came to the U.S. Some Methodist Christians in America got her to the U.S., got her to Atlanta. She finished her medical studies at Emory. Worked at our Centers for Disease Control there. And then after the fall of the Soviet Union, God began calling Chris's heart. Chris, who had been abused and rejected by the Russians. God began touching Chris's heart, and Chris ended up going and serving as a Methodist medical missionary in eastern Kazakhstan. Chris served for 15 years in the city in eastern Kazakhstan. In America, when we did our nuclear testing, we were smart enough to do it where there weren't many people, out in the desert in Nevada or in the South Pacific. The Russians did their nuclear testing, like, right over there, like in the next neighborhood, next to massive cities. And those cities today still suffer from cancer rates and deformed children born with missing limbs and all kind of crazy stuff. Chris went and served. She had half of a Russian medical degree, and so they licensed her as a doctor to serve in that country. And she touched the lives of men and women and children, both with her medical care and with the gospel of Jesus Christ for 15 years. Tell me you don't think God is in control? To find a Russian-speaking Liberian woman doctor and put her in Kazakhstan where she could serve among some of the most hurting people in the world? God is in control. You make a choice. God will tell you by the Spirit. You ask Him. The Spirit is telling you, what choice do you need to make today to take a step of growth in your relationship with Him? What step? It may be something that doesn't make sense to anybody else, like Daniel chose not to eat this food and to eat these vegetables instead. It may be a decision that doesn't make sense to anyone else. It lines up with the Word of God. And God's calling you to make that step. And it's going to make a difference for you, because later down the road, you'll make this step. You'll say yes to God. And down the road, you'll realize that He was in control. And your life will turn out different. 66 years later, Daniel, still serving the Lord and serving His people. God is in control. What will God do in 66 years from now in your life? I don't think I'll still be around in 66 years, but somebody else will be. Daniel wasn't around much longer after that, but after that, the people were encouraged by his story, and we're still today reading his story. Friends, God's in control. Your choices matter. Choose confidently to love. Choose confidently to love Him and serve Him and trust that He is in control in your world and in our world. In Jesus' name, amen. Will you pray with me? God, pour out your Spirit for us right now that we could have clarity to know how you are calling us to order our lives in a way that's in line with your Spirit, in a way that's in line with your Word, that we could choose to say yes, like Daniel said yes, to this way of study and this way of living, that we could trust that you're in control even when we don't see immediate fruit, when we don't see your immediate answer. Help us to trust in you. And to know that you're on the throne and you're working behind the scenes. God, just take our faith in you, our trust in you. Take our obedience for you. And work in us by your grace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be His than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or land. I'd rather be led by His nail-pierced hand than to be the king of a vast domain and be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords to.
I hope that is true for every one of you, that you'd rather have Jesus than anything else. And I want to tell you, this is true too. This is true too. Jesus would rather have you. Jesus would rather have you than anything else in the world. He loves you and He's made you. You belong to Him. From the beginning of time, you've belonged to Him. He'd rather have you. So go from this place knowing of His great love, knowing the depth of His mercy that's poured out for you. Go in hope and in peace to love and serve in the world. In Jesus' name, go. Amen.